contributing and helping us develop these profile, these personas out, let us know. This is very unusual. People very rarely talk about this kind of thing. Oftentimes because it's done by third-party agencies who that's how they make their money, and so they don't want to talk about it. But in speaking with people, there's a lot of people reinventing the wheel, especially in marketing processes. And so the beauty of open source is that you don't have to keep doing the same thing over and over again. But for some reason, you know, after that product is done and it gets to the marketing department, it's like going back in time before open source existed and pretending that it wasn't there. And this comes to messaging. Messaging is an exciting topic because there's different opinions on it. Some people think you should be sort of full-throated, shout from the hilltops that this is open source and that that's the most important thing. Other projects and companies think that it's something that should be maybe in the footer of the page or somewhere on a GitHub repository. But short messages here, you can definitely market that you are open, that your product is open, that it respects user freedom. People do care about that. But there's a lot of things outside of that. The company I'm highlighting here is System76. So they're a GNU Linux computer maker in Denver, Colorado. I spoke with Luisa, who heads up the marketing for that company, and we use their machines at work. So if you're a company and you're buying computers for your open hardware company, they ought to be running GNU Linux, and they ought to be from System76 or from ThinkPenguin or from some other manufacturer like that, because you have a great opportunity to support other companies that are doing really neat things. And if that doesn't make sense, that's fine, but realize again, you have a choice there. There are options. They make beautiful computers. I use them literally every day because I have a personal one and a work one. They work really well. This isn't just like a charity purchase. It's a good computer. And so what they did is they ran a campaign. They had historically the 4th of July weekend, which is a big holiday in the United States, is slow for sales for them. So they decided to do a campaign focused on freedom and user freedom and getting people's attention around the idea of freedom. This is the most important thing, right? Sales, how did it work? Their year over year profitability went up by over 50%. It went up even more in year two. They did a really cool campaign on social media and posting blog posts about it. And you know, you'd think that they make Ubuntu computers. People already know that they care about freedom, but they were able to reemphasize that and tie it in with another cultural event, a holiday, and increase their sales. So even if it's a message that you've talked about a lot before around openness, maybe there's a new way that you can package it to represent it to users to get them excited. Content. So this is one that surprises me the most because there are some folks I meet that are really dedicated and committed to these ideas. If you look at their code, everything is documented, all the licenses, it's like airtight. Then you go to their website and there's no notice or information about copyright. Or you look in the documentation, it's like the most thorough, incredible thing you've ever read. It's like moving, it's like keeping you up at night. It's so well written, but it doesn't say anywhere that it's using a Creative Commons license or the GNU documentation license or something like that. So wanted to highlight, a project called SatNogs. So for the hardware folks, this is a really cool hardware project. They're basically building a network of ground satellite stations that communicate to low orbit satellites. And Eleftherios they're based in Greece. He heads up, we've got a video, here you go. Basically shows the idea of like what their hardware looks like. All of their content is freely licensed. All their videos, all their blog posts, all their documentation. So you know, use free culture licenses so that people can learn and share your documentation. And then finally, support. So this is a really quick and simple one, but if you're working with file formats, if you're customer facing, support free software projects. Osh Park here in Portland, in Lake Oswego. I spoke with Drew. You know, he told me and basically walked through the process of them accepting KiCad formats for their boards, and it's been a really big hit. They said that customers have been excited about it. When we order boards from Osh Park, we use KiCad format and submit it to them. It's a really easy way to communicate, to signal to the open source community that you care, that you share those values. And sometimes it can just be a very small lift. Other things like using WebM and other non-proprietary file formats on your website and things like that. They're little things, but they really add up. So just kind of wrapping up, I am not the only person talking about this. There's many, many, many people that have spoken about this. Someone following me here is Tracy Irway from Intel, who gave a great talk on open source marketing a couple years ago at a Linux conference. So, you know, follow these people. I'm just one person here of many, many. Thinking that Twitter's been a good platform, so if this is interesting, try using this hashtag. If it doesn't work, that's fine, just email me. But I'm hoping that there might be a way to spur a conversation here. These are all the tools we use. This presentation was done in free software. Check out reveal.js. And then we've got all the source and attribution, because walk the walk, or at least trying to. So thank you very much for your time. Appreciate it, and have a good day.
Thanks so much. Before I introduce the next speaker, I want to introduce Chris, who's in the photo booth. And actually, he was just here behind the curtain. He is the man behind the curtain. There he is in the back. So I want to just give us a little bit of an intro about Chris and the photo booth back there. Second year running, Chris has been doing this. You can get your professional photo done with him in the back, or a fun photo with your friends. He does both, and he does great job. A lot of the photos from last year you can also see on our Flickr account, so definitely go visit him. You can even do it during the speakers, as long as they don't think you're rude in doing so. So, okay, great. Next presenter is Tracy Irway from Intel, who's going to be speaking about open source at Intel. So, thanks so much. Let me just get this for you. This is yours, right? Is
yeah,
yours
that's me.
Okay, I'll go over here, and then presentation mode, you should be good. Ready?
I guess. Oh, how do I move it? Hello, I'm Tracy Irway, and I do work at Intel, and I'm also a member of the Minoboard team, which is a lot of folks at Intel and a few other places as well. I have some questions. Who here works at Intel? Could you raise your hand? So I know how to do damage control later. And they're all spread out. They aren't sitting together. It's amazing. I have a bunch of questions to ask because I've never been here before. I thought I'd be in a little room off on the side with 20 people. There's a lot of you out there, and I don't know anything about you. So who here is a hardware developer? Ooh, awesome. Who here would say they are a software developer? Oh, my. Did anyone play both sides and try to confuse me? Thanks a lot. All right, yeah. Now I want to ask a couple more questions, because I'm here from Intel, which is a big, massive, huge company, and so we have some issues, which is what I'm here to talk about. I want to know about you guys. So who works for a company with 10 people or less? Sizable. How about 100 people or less? Same amount. 1,000 people or less? And how about the big, huge companies? Who's there? There's a few people. Okay. All right. Here we go. I know you all think I was here to talk about how we were going to open source our chips from now until forever. I'm really not, and I think I'd definitely be fired if I said that we were. So that's not what this talk is about at all. I do want to show some of the boards that we have that are open source hardware to a certain extent. They're either, as I say, somewhat open. They're open in a way that the ecosystem can do open source things with them. And some of them are primarily open source. So I'm talking about Galileo, Edison, Joule, and Minoboard. So who here has ever heard of the Minoboard? Seriously? Is that just because you read the fanatic part on the... because Minoboard people are definitely fanatics. So at the end of this, if I ask that same question, if I don't see every hand go up, then you're all fired. I'm just going to let you know. What's interesting about these boards from Intel is they all have some degree of open source hardware-ish associated with them. And really what drove the decisions as to what they were going to release in an open source hardware manner was really the strategy behind the program. So there's a very big difference between a program that develops a board that needs to sell a lot of volume to make them worthwhile, and versus, say, a program that really wants to sell the design in a way that other people can create the high volume. And so I would differentiate between the Intel-branded products and Minnow Board. And Minnow Board, Jason, wherever you are, thank you. I'm going to, I just would like to thank BeagleBoard because we actually, we took the Minnow Board program and we designed it the way BeagleBoard was designed because he had so many great ideas. We just stole them. And yeah, and they work great. I mean, we do our own thing too, but the whole premise with a nonprofit, and I'll explain a little bit later on why we did it that way, in fact. So there's a big difference between Intel branded boards and how open they're gonna be versus the Minnow Board, for instance. For us on the Minnow Board program, and there are a few, Minnow boarders out there, it boiled down to two things, you know, the easy stuff and the really hard stuff. So this is what was easy. Absolutely nothing in the program was easy. It started, the Minnow Board program started off with a bunch of software people who needed a little board. And so we thought, okay, we'll just make a little board. No one had made a little board that had an Intel processor on it that was low cost and easily accessible, and we thought it can't be that hard. Certainly someone can design an Intel board that is smaller than a power supply and actually use it for, you know, software development. And so we started to figure out the hard stuff. And this is really my last foil because all this stuff is hard, every single piece of it. And it's hard primarily, I think, because of Intel's size and Intel's visibility and Intel's stature in the market, and certainly who's looking at us in terms of what we're doing and how responsible we are, what our quality is, what our support model is like. All those different things are important to the industry when they look at Intel. So the first three, the value proposition, education, and changing a culture. If you think about Intel, anyone who's done any kind of reading or listening about Intel, we have been primarily a paranoid, I would say the two P's, paranoia. We're very paranoid from Andy Grove days. And also we're very proprietary. I mean, we have built a business on our IP, and our IP has been hugely important to our success and hugely important to who we are. And so our internal culture is still very much focused that way. If you look at an open source hardware program, it really says, here, take what I have, use it in a way that you want to use it, and use it over and over again. We don't care what you do with it, take it, do whatever. Try not to complain too much when things are wrong. I shouldn't say that. But that's a very hard thing to get across internally at Intel, and probably a very hard thing to get across at any big company that has really grown their value based on their own personal products. And it's a scary thing to say, here, take what we have and do what you want to it. So changing the culture internally is very important, at least on a per project basis, or at least on the people who you have to deal with who are involved in the project, because there is no project at Intel, even though we're huge and we have individual projects all around the company, you invariably need to work with other divisions and other groups and other capabilities across the company to make yourself and your project successful. So changing that culture across the company is very difficult. I would say we probably started working on Minnow Board in about, where's Scott Garmin, 2013 maybe a little bit sooner than that. And it was much more difficult at that point than it is now in 2016 going into 2017. We have a huge amount of support internally. And that wasn't there yet because people didn't understand why we would be doing open source hardware. And what's crucial about changing the internal culture is that you need to change that culture so that you make the right decisions. And the right decisions, really, between the value proposition and educating and the culture are based on what's right for the community. Because without the community, an open source hardware project is going nowhere, nowhere fast. So nowhere do you see community on this foil, and it really should be. But the first three things on this list really do point to community. So for Intel, branding, you know, I think Forbes says we're in the top 20 brands in the world, Intel. And we really are. And so branding for a company of our size is so precious that I skipped over the first slide really quickly because I was, you know, did I get that circle R on there? Did I get all the right things with Intel's name? Intel's brand is very important. And so immediately when we wanted to do an open source hardware project, it was a little bit dicey to get it through all the branding processes. So we chose not to. We followed the BeagleBoard program, and we created a nonprofit and a foundation so that we could create our own brand and play with the program a little bit and see how successful we could make it, how useful we could make it, and how much value we could actually give back to Intel, to the community, to the participants in the overall program. So branding is an issue for a really large company and how you deal with it and how you move forward. But the other boards that Intel puts out, Edison, Galileo, Juul, all those, you know, they have the Intel brand and they have, and they are less open if you compare the two. So it's hard for a company that has that much stature in the industry. Licensing. We were so very lucky to be part of the Open Source Technology Center at Intel because we know so much about open source software. And we had internal processes that would pull in licensing and legal matters and review things. So we actually have to review everything and have it approved by our body of experts before we can release anything externally. And even though the Minnow board doesn't have to necessarily go through that process, we take it through the process anyway because Intel is associated with Minnow board as well. No, I need more than 5 minutes. That's ridiculous. So I want to talk about firmware because, thank you very much. I want to talk about firmware because this was a huge issue for us and a huge success. When we started the program, our firmware was totally closed. It was like one blob. Never going to get into that firmware. And we worked with our firmware teams and Tiana Core and now a majority of the firmware that is associated with the Minnow board is accessible to someone who's doing development, who needs to bring up a new derivative board, who needs to do whatever. Never would have happened before this program. So this was a huge win internally. Very excited to see our firmware teams out at open source conferences now, like ELC. Regulatory, I really only do have like 3 minutes, so this is the biggest one on this list for anyone who's in a big company. So most of you may or may not be aware that to actually release boards, they have to consumers, they have to pass a certain status with the FCC, at least in the United States. And there's a lot more to regulatory than FCC worldwide. But what really brought us to a halt with the Minnow board program was this issue, and primarily because Intel is huge and very visible to the FCC. So you will never see a board released from now on through the Minnow board program unless it's a Class B board, meaning you can take it home, you can use it with all your other consumer devices, it's not going to interfere, you can take it and put it right in your product the way it is, you can take the design, it's going to have a really great chance of passing FCC for your own product if you change it and want to recreate it. So I can't speak for anybody else, but I can tell you there are a lot of products out there that do not have this capability and do not have this requirement, and it adds a huge expense and a huge amount of time. So regulatory is brutal for a big company like Intel, but we're absolutely determined to fulfill what we have to in that regard. So. And luckily, it'll pass on in our open source hardware program as well, because our designs will be that solid that you should be able to pretty closely recreate. Darn it, down to a minute? I'm sure I am. Roadmap, an open source hardware program. We didn't design our roadmap, and you know our roadmap is set for a long period of time. We didn't necessarily design it for people to be able to easily manufacture. So a roadmap is now questionable. And the last thing I want to tell you before I go is what we did differently with manufacturing requirements. At Intel, you can imagine we build a lot of boards, a lot of things. And so if you have a resistor that goes into 1,000 boards, you can buy those resistors at a very low cost. But if you want someone to recreate your board through open source hardware, you don't want them to pay 20 times what you paid. So for the Minnow board program in particular, and the reason why we really paid attention to this was so that people could manufacture these boards easily, even if they didn't get high volume discounts as Intel would, even if they and were able to actually manufacture, solder, and build the boards without having some incredible fab that Intel may have the ability to access through our size and volume. So the manufacturing piece is huge, regulatory is huge, the culture is huge. We really hope that with Minnow board that we're gonna be able to hit all of these things effectively so that anyone here can take our designs and do derivative boards and be very, very successful with them. And that's it. So there you go. Oh yeah, so who's heard of Minnow board now?
Thanks so much. Our next presenters are Shigeru Kobayashi and Genta Kondo, and they're talking about designing an ecosystem to drive an open source hardware project. I hope I got your names correct. Please welcome them.
So, hello. So, I'm Shigeru from Japan. So, I designed Arduino Fire 6 years ago in collaboration with Spectrum. So, I'm really happy to see many projects utilizing the board so far. So, and strongly believe that open source hardware is an effective concept like you. So today, to develop discussion on opportunities and challenges of open source hardware, so I would like to introduce the Hackberry project. It's a little bit more complicated and sophisticated project, so including mechanical parts, so by Genta, so Genta and his team. So Genta, could you please introduce your vision and your project?
Okay, hello, I'm Genta from ICSI Inc. I've been working on this open source 3D printable bionic hand. Bionic hand is kind of a robotic hand for people who lost their hand or who doesn't have their hand from birth. First, I would like to show you what kind of world I want to make using these images. So, 3D printing is not only to reduce the cost of manufacturing, but it's also to make it easier for people to make things as cooking a meal. So I imagine that in a few years' time frame, a girl who is missing hand can make her original hand together with her mom just by looking through the catalog on the internet. And also adding some kind of heart mark so she can arrange it and have like her really original hand. So that's my vision on the 3D printing part. And also open sourcing. Open source is not only to spread our data to the world, not only to like make many of copies. Another objective of open sourcing is to integrate lots of partial technology. Because I know that in many labs around the world, they're working day and night to improve their kind of patented technology. But most of the time, it's really difficult for them to combine them all to make one bionic hand. So since I have this simple platform, there's not much technology inside it. It's just the integration of it. So each lab, if they come up with new idea, they can just add on to this platform. So that's what I see for the 3D printing and open source ultimately. So let me briefly give a technical explanation how bionic hand works. So let's take a look at unimpaired person first. So when you move your hand, if you don't mind, you can do it together with me. So when you open and close your hand, first thing that happens is the image of the motion. So it arrives in the brain first, and then it goes through the motor neuron and some stimuli, electrical stimuli, contracts the muscle. And finally, this muscle will move the joint. So like this is the precise process of when you move the hand. And for people who lost it or who doesn't have it, they don't have their hand, but they still have the muscle unless they're paralyzed. So what bionic hand does is to collect the muscle signal artificially and converts it to the motion of robotic hand. So I'll quickly show the demo. So here's the sensor I have, and this sensor gonna collect my muscle activity. Like even if I lose my hand, I still have this arm part. And like this, I'm actually contracting my arm, and this contraction is sensed, and it is sent to the robotic hand so that I can control this robotic hand pretty intuitively. Thank you. I'll be doing demo later, so if you want to try, just stop by and ask me. So, what I want to emphasize here is the hand is not only for physical functionality. Another yet important part of the hand is expression, I think. So imagine your hobby or your favorite pastime, even if it's like sports or music or even like playing video games, the hand plays the central role. So this expression is what I really want to focus on this Hackberry project. And this movie is, let me see. So this guy actually lost his right hand by a factory accident 3 years ago. And on the left-hand side, that hand was the first hand he got from the doctor. It has a physical function to open and close, but its appearance is kind of miserable, and people around him kind of hesitated to talk with him about the hand. But on the right-hand side, it is our earlier prototype called Handy Coyote. Since we put a focus design a lot, it's the same physical function to open and close, but people around him can easily and positively ask him what happened. And like this kind of kids also get interested, and they are first afraid, but like after a few seconds, they start to shake hands and please look at their smiley face. So I think this will be kind of proof that the prosthetic hand or bionic hand is not to hide or conceal or compensate the missing piece of the hand, but it's rather to express their personality. So here's another example. This lady is a singer, and you can see that she is missing right hand. She was born without a hand, which means she can basically do everything, every daily task by herself, but only thing she really wanted to do was to make a gestures on her live performance, because she thought her musical expression was restricted, even though she can hold a microphone by her natural left hand and sing a song beautifully. So what we did last year was to provide her with this hand and made her first live performance with gestures. What I want to mention here is that it's really niche use case, I think. Like, not everybody missing a hand want to make a gestures, and not everybody is having a live performance. But it is one and only dream she wanted to accomplish. I think every person has like really unique story, and to fulfill all of them, I think this kind of framing is important. So it's not only the product, not only the universal product, which I can mass produce and send it to everybody. Product is only the first layer. And I think there should be community layer on top of it. And from those community, many unique personal stories can come out. So that's why I started open sourcing last May. It's been like 1.5 years. Almost. If you check our GitHub page, it is github.com/hackberry. And you can find CAD CAD data, STL file, and also PCB board, Arduino sketch, and also build material. So everything is on the GitHub page. On top of that, we have a portal, xc-hackberry.com, where you can find forum and also tutorials, so which makes you easier to start building it. And once you printed the body parts and prepare some electronic and mechanical parts, which is available around the world, you can at least build a copy of this hand. And it's been really successful so far. It's been spreading out around the world, of course, US, EU, and many parts in Asia. I'm gonna show one example of the potential of open source project. So this project is from Poland in EU, not Portland, but Poland. So basically what they did was they made a kit size left-hand version of this hackberry hand. We only have right-hand adult size version on our GitHub page first. But one engineer customized it to provide it to this boy, and he reduced the size to 70%. Since the sensor is still large for a 5-year-old kid, so he has to wear the sensor on the right hand. So it's not completed yet, but at least this boy can know what it feels to have left hand. And I didn't ask him to make this neat movie, but this guy called Valdus understand our concept, and he posted this YouTube, really nice YouTube video. The company is called V Bionic. I think they also started a company there, so if you're interested, please check the V Bionic. Well, fish too. Speaking about community, I also think local community is important. Besides, you know, open source community, which is virtual and spreading out globally, in local community we can talk on face-to-face spaces. And yeah, so in Tokyo, Japan, I'm having a monthly meetup where people being involved to Bionic Hand can gather together, including amputee themselves, engineers, and also medical professionals like therapists, doctors, and there's people called prosthetists who are making the conventional prosthetic hands. So this is a glimpse of our meetup on the left top picture, like all of them. There's almost 10 people there. They are all missing hand, but they're wearing our hackberry hand together, so they can have a user test in like really fun atmosphere. We're also sharing our talents so that engineer can show how to solder, and prosthetists can show how to make conventional prosthetic, especially the socket part, which you have to customize to each person. You know, shape and size is different. So we're having this local community too, and from this community, we're doing hackberry development in grassroots manner. So this boy in white and red shirt is missing right hand, and his limb is kind of short, so it's more difficult than usual to attach the hand to his limb. So other guy, he's a prosthesis, is helping him. I mean, it's collaboration of them too, and they're trying to come up with like fixed socket which he can hold a hand for kind of whole day. And it's not only like in developing it, I'm encouraging them to show the process, how they trial and error process. So in the monthly meetup, they're also having a presentation like that. So this is what we're doing. And so talking about license, we first did Creative Commons license, BY and SA, but we changed, we added NC later. Also we changed the Arduino Sketch license too. It was, the reason was twofold. First, honestly speaking, we had to make money somehow to make this project sustainable. We have to pay ourselves too. The other reason was that they're having people asking us that, is it really okay to like make start business with this data? And also just people who didn't want to share their derivatives too. So we made it straightforward that as an open source, it have to be follow the rules. But we also prepared another way that we can have a contract individually customized for their purpose. So.
So thank you very much. So it looks like so you achieved some positive goals so by you know, choosing open source as a strategy. So could you please share your lessons learned from the project?
I only introduced the successful side, but there's lots of challenges too. So first, the Poland case, the kit size version one, it is not open source yet. It is because you know hardware requires lots of manual procedures, and having a working model doesn't necessarily mean it is in digital format. That's a huge difference from open source software, I think. So that's one challenge I'm facing now. The second challenge is that even though in our local community they're trying to make the socket for a short limb boy, but it hasn't been completed yet, and since it's voluntary basis, I cannot say him to finish fast or like run fast. So there have to be some you know good rule in the ecosystem, and that kind of design of the community should be also open sourced, I think. And last but not least, after we changed the license, many entities actually asked us that they want a customized license and they want to start mass productions. And we said yes, and I allowed them to do it in like really good deal, but it never happened. So even though we keep designing the rules, it's still hard for hardware to get from the prototyping stage to the mass production stage. So,
yeah. So thank you very much. So and so I have a very quick announcement. So I supported the project with a lawyer. So to designing the terms of use. So and so now the terms of use as a and available as a template. So and kindly, the Open Hardware Summit official account tweeted the link, so maybe you can find easily. So and maybe you can utilize that for your project. So and do you have any final remarks?
Okay. So yes, as a final remarks, I want to show this picture, which is our one of my goal with the user. So the guy who was shaking hand. In the very first movie, he was enjoying paraglider before he lost his right hand by an accident 3 years ago. So our personal goal is to make him fly again one day in a really cool manner. So thank you for listening.
That's really cool. Thank you so much. Our next presenter is Bilal Ghalib.
So while he's preparing the slides, who here feels like you can make what you can imagine? Some people, yeah? So like, yes, we can make it. Can I hear somebody do that? Maybe we can make it. I hope we can make it. I really believe that there's so much creative potential in this room that if we really got together, we can make something amazing. Who believes that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Who believes that we've got some good electrical engineers up in here? What about some really amazing software designers? And shout out to all the hardware people. Yeah, okay. So the big question that I have is, when you can make anything, what are you gonna make?
Rockets.
Everything.
Things to make the world better.
Things to make the world better, but how do you figure that out? Isn't that hard? It's like, what are you gonna just think about the world? Hey, what up, boy, man, Ann Arbor in the house, in the his house. All right, so I guess you figured out one thing about me. I'm from the Midwest, and no, big way, Detroit love. And another thing about me is I'm brown. I don't know if you noticed. I'm from, my parents are from Iraq. I was born in Evanston, Illinois, and my slides are up. This is my hello. And that was my question. I wanted to ask you guys, when we can make anything, what do we make? And I've come up with this idea because 5 years ago, literally 5 years ago to this day, I flew from Ann Arbor, Michigan to Cairo, Egypt to do a pop-up hackerspace with people that I met online. And I was like, we need the maker movement to go global. It was more Western 5 years ago. It wasn't spread over China in the house. Eric Pan, Seed Studio, these kinds of places were just beginning to go global. And so I felt like I was in this interesting position where I spoke Arabic, I spoke English, and I had access to something that I felt would be really amazing to share in the middle of the Arab Spring, when people were getting together in communities to try to take control of their futures, more politically. And I thought we could take control more tangibly, because open source hardware addresses physical needs. And it was such an amazing idea, and I was really excited to go. And 5 years later, here I am in the Middle East. I decided that I would leave San Francisco and go to, how do I click? The right arrow. The right arrow. Okay. Woohoo!
Does that work?
Ah, okay, good. Oh, 1 second, 1 second, bro. Okay. So, what do you guys think of when you think of the Middle East?
Pyramids.
Pyramids? That's awesome. Falafel, you guys are amazing. You guys must not be on Facebook at all. You guys are super productive. You guys got, you know, Lawrence of Arabia, the classics. The kind of Middle East that I see when I look on the news is full of bombs, political unrest, violence, and all of my friends living there. And so what happened was 4 years ago, 5 years ago, I started working in the Middle East. Got really excited about doing this stuff. Was working in San Francisco, and this is Beirut. But they're not, the videos aren't playing. Oh, and this is also Beirut. So Beirut is a beautiful place. There is a lot of amazing history. There's beautiful architecture and remnants from a civil war that never really ended, along with a bunch of crises that are coming up. So this is one of the problems in Beirut. This is the trash crisis. About a year ago, the government in Lebanon was like, huh, I guess our landfill filled up. And people were like, so where does the trash go? And the government was like, I don't know. What about you figure it out? And so local governments were charged with figuring out where to put the trash, and people were charged with cities filling up with the foulest smelling thing you could imagine. And so this is actually right in front of Beirut Digital District. This is where startups are. All the startups are in front of this burning pile of trash. I don't know if that's a metaphor for Silicon Valley, but I'm sorry. I love San Francisco. I've lived there for a long time. Good people. But so this is the stuff that I was facing. And so initially, you know, when you come with this really empowering idea that we can make anything, we're going to get together into communities and build the future, you kind of ask yourself, what are we going to make? Especially when it's physical, especially when it's hardware. We're at the Open Source Hardware Summit. And so What happened was last year I got invited by the Noaya Network. It's a group of women, actually I'm the only man in the entire office, who are working on bringing an innovation lab into the refugee camps. So I gave my talk a couple years ago. I was in a Syrian refugee camp trying to bring alternative education, and I talked about how much I failed at it and how much misery I felt after my school got bombed and the girls died that I was working with, and how I had no idea how to deal with this kind of development work, and I was just lost. Basically, my talk was about me being like, I can't do anything, right? I don't even know what to do anymore. I don't want to make anything. And they were like, no, let's try again. And so I decided to come back to Lebanon and work with the Noaya Network and these happy, beautiful, smiling people to take DIY and open source methodologies into refugees. So Lebanon has 1.5 million Syrians that just came over. They have a giant border. They don't really know how to close it. And so Syrians come in, surprise. And they have about 500,000 Palestinians that came over since the crisis more than 50 years ago. And where do you think the Syrians go? Into these refugee camps. This is what DIY infrastructure looks like. So, no, I'm serious. This is 50 years of developments and people working on creating internet, waterways, codes for buildings. And that young man over there in the middle on the bottom, you can see that kid. He actually was electrocuted last year because of this. And this are these are the tubes. And so all of these people, the Syrians, the poor Lebanese people that can't afford the middle of the city, the Palestinians, they've all converged into what has become a slum, in essence. It's called Burj al Barajne, but I also called it my second home for about a month when me and Noaya were running our programming in this place. And this is why people get electrocuted. You can see the water runs parallel with the electricity, and basically the walls become electrified, especially in the winter when it rains. So people are just like, walking around, wearing the tank tops, brushing against the wall, and then are electrocuted, which is a terrible thing. And so one of the problems that the youth brought up, this is one of the youth, his name is Mohammed, he's one of my favorite people. He became sort of like my right-hand man, and he's one of the youths that we wound up working with in these camps, and his dream is to be an inventor. He was telling me, like, one day I thought to myself, how do we stop metals from rusting? And these are the questions he asks himself because they're problems that he's facing. And do you know why he asked himself this question? You know what? Literally, this moment, I just figured out why he asked that question. Because all of the water in the refugee camp is rusty. What water does? What? It's salty. It's freaking salty water. You go to the tap. So one day I was in the refugee camp. I was about to wash up for prayer, right? So I'm sitting there, I'm washing up. And then I put a little bit of the water in my mouth. And I was like, what is this? The water is salty. People, you know, a fish doesn't know it's wet. The youth, when you ask them, like, tell us about problems in your camp, and they say electrocutions because people die. But they don't say, we're bathing in salt water. You know, imagine you went swimming in the ocean and you could never wash. That's what it's like. And so this is Mohammed, and he was wondering about, how do I be an inventor? How do I solve this problem? And so I do two things. I do four things, at least. But in Lebanon, I work on this innovation and prototyping with refugees, Palestinians, Syrians, and marginalized Lebanese people. But I also like making stuff as examples for what we do with our creative potential. And I want to try addressing some serious challenges. And so when I saw the water getting poisoned, actually, what happened with me is this. So last year, I came up with this idea called See, Feel, Do, to answer the question of when we can make anything, what do we make? And you guys feel free to do this. It starts with seeing. You can draw it on your arm or your hand. It's an eye. And then you draw a heart, and that's for the feel. And then the do is represented by your hands. And so when I was in the camps, I tasted that water. And at home, what happened with me was the government, since 2006, was not able to provide water because of the war damaging the water infrastructure. And so I was bathing with 0.5 liter of water in a bucket in the shower, and I thought to myself, this is ridiculous because this is the water infrastructure, but this is my rooftop. So you see what we have over there is a giant sea. I don't know if you can see it. This is actually the view from my house, and I have some rooms available if anybody wants to come visit, for sure. That's a giant sea. And then these tanks are also really cool because the way that people solved their water problem after the water pipes were damaged in the war, they started getting shipped water. So somebody would go find a well or something that was clean enough and bring a big tank of water over your house. And you pour it into the basement, and then it would get pumped up, and then it would get stored in these tanks until you needed to use it. And I saw that as an ideal situation. If you see here, we have, what's one of the really useful things you can see in this picture? Come on, I know you guys are smart. We got satellites, we got the sea. The sun, oh my God, I thought no one was gonna see it because it's too obvious, but yes, we have a lot of freaking sunlight. And so I started working on these prototypes. I started going and I would go to the camps and I would work with the youth and I'd do my trainings in the morning and then I'd run off to the welder. The cool thing about a city being in 1 square kilometer with 40,000 people is that everything is in 1 square kilometer. So I would go over to this guy and be like, yo, bro, can you like weld me up some stuff? And I'm like, literally, you know, the back of this napkin kind of sketch thing? I'd give it to him and I'd be like, I want this. And he'd go and he'd weld it up for me and I'd take it home. And initially I thought about using corrugated plastic because it was all over the place in the trash. And I thought like, what if we could make an origami water purifier that we just fold together and put glass on it and then boom. That was kind of tough. And so I decided to make it out of metal and I started prototyping it. And I thought I was so smart and I was doing something amazing. And then I go into class one day and one girl comes up to me and she's like, why do we have to buy bottled water? And I was like, and I was so happy. I was so happy to see people asking these really interesting and hard questions in the class. And so we started prototyping these water purifiers. This is activated charcoal using salt and sand and different sorts of filters. And she's actually in process right now. I think she hasn't finished the third part of her training, which is the business development aspect of the program that I'm doing with GEMC and Nawaya. And so what I want to do now is I want to continue bringing you to Lebanon. I want you guys to connect to these people because what we're doing right now is we're doing the C part of CFLDU. Surprise, surprise. Uh-oh. And so this is Suhaila. And I think you guys can really maybe like connect with her because she is a woman in a refugee camp and she's a Syrian refugee who can't work because Lebanon has 1.5 million Syrians and I think a population of 4 million or something like that of Lebanese. And they're worried about their jobs for their young people. And so they basically say to the Syrians, you can work in agriculture, you can work in construction, or you work in trash. And Suhaila especially has another problem, and I don't know if you can see it, I don't know if you can see her problem, it's kind of hard to tell, but she's a woman. I know it doesn't sound like a problem, but it is. Like, especially in her context, in her situation, being a woman makes it really hard to work. And so she thought to herself, this is a great opportunity, which is one of the ways that we try to look at problems in this program. It's like, how do you look at something that sucks and think about solutions? And so she started this project to kind of like poke fun at the male-dominated kind of workforce. And she said, my program is called She is Adam. And what I do is I teach women to fix electronics at home so that we can employ them without having to take them out into the public and get them in trouble for running a business or like basically make your own jobs. And that is an amazing solution. And I'm not sure exactly how to help her, but we're getting to the point where I ask you something. And I'll let you know what I'm gonna ask you in a little bit. So this is Suhaila, she's pretty amazing. How do we connect over here now that we've connected a little bit with the story and like seeing these people? The first thing that took me to Lebanon, I'm not even Lebanese, my family is Iraqi, but I'm too scared to go there. No, I'm serious. Like, I went there for a bunch of years, and then one day I think my name got on a blacklist of some people that I won't mention that I'm kind of afraid of mentioning. Anyway, so I'm not going back for a little bit. But I go to Lebanon, and Lebanon's great, and it's beautiful, and it's safe enough, so welcome. So the first thing that I did was 4 years ago, I went and I helped set up this crew called Lumba Labs, and I ran a Kickstarter. Who here has backed any of my Kickstarters? Somebody, yeah, okay, great. Well, this is the result of your hard work. I'm sorry for all the people that I didn't ship you t-shirts or forgot your comic or your stickers. I'm sorry. But what you can see here is Lumba Labs kicking off again 4 years later. We're starting our space. And if you want to connect to these amazing people in the Middle East that speak your language, both English and electronics and hardware, software, please go onto Lumba Labs on Facebook or Twitter and give them a shout out. Another organization that's doing amazing stuff that you can connect with is Alt City. Alt City is interested in helping people solve problems and run businesses, especially interested in social enterprises because those are the best enterprises. Screw the word social. Businesses that solve problems kick a lot of butt and make a lot of money. And so I work with Alt City, and this is some of the community building that we do. We take find people that are interested in the future of education or the future of fintech or the future of different sorts of like green tech. And we tell them, you can organize meetings, you can build knowledge in your field of interest, and you can make awesome stuff happen. So that's Alt City that you can also connect with. One of these organizations that I work with is called Anansi. Anansi has a logo that looks like a spider web, and Anansi is the name of a spider also. But what Anansi does is, we just released it actually, if you look on the blog, we just released a map of maps. So a map for all the innovation spaces, hubs, tech hubs, fab labs, makerspaces, all of them all together in one place, so that all of these activities that we're doing out in the world can be integrated a little bit better. And I think there have been a lot of these like GitHubs for hardware, and the thing that is missing is, I think, the personal connection. And this is where I'm getting to. The gig is the Global Innovation Gathering. This is the personal connection. This is where people get together. So in Berlin this year, you can see some of our friends from over there. There's Tarek from Cairo, and Jay from London, and we're gonna see some Samer from Palestine. And these are people from all over the world, and Hakim from South Sudan. And they all get together, and they're all running either community spaces or makerspaces and hubs where people are building and sharing knowledge together. And so the hugs that I've shown you and the stories that I've told you and all of this that I'm sharing, I'm trying to let you guys see people so that you can connect to them, so that we can decide to work. And some of the problems that are being faced by people that you think are very far away is coming. It's coming for us all. I don't want to sound threatening or like, oh my God, the world is ending, but like the challenges of water scarcity and the pollution that people are facing in the Middle East are the challenges of global climate change. And the populations that are being pushed out of their homes and being pushed into Europe and the rest of the world, it's coming to affect us all. And so the thing that I would like to do is, I want you guys to see Ranin over there. She wants to start a photo studio for women. And I'm asking and I'm looking for anybody that wants to be a mentor, somebody that wants to share their knowledge or their expertise. Okay, one weird question. Who speaks Arabic in here? Okay, you got one? Somebody halfway? Great, I already have two volunteers for mentorships. This is awesome, okay. And then my talk wasn't done in vain. So please follow all of these people, and if anybody knows anybody that speaks in Arabic or is willing to try to figure out how to share our knowledge and experience, the way that we make the thing that's really hard about open source hardware is that you can't just share files and expect somebody to make it. Even Precious Plastics, who's heard of this project? It's so well documented, it's so amazing, but still I think we need hands-on education. We need people to not only share their information, but share their care, their feelings, and their support in helping basically doulas. We need open source doulas to help other people in the world birth your projects. We need to support other people. That's what I wanted to bring. And please tell me if you want to be a mentor. There's a lot of people that we can get connected to, and let's make awesome stuff happen. Boom. Last thing, my friend Mohammed, the guy that wants to be an inventor, has an awesome rap that I recorded in 360. If anybody has an Oculus or one of those Google Cardboards, come to me and we can. I'll take you into the camp. I can take you virtually into the refugee camp to see what it's like to hear Mohammed rap. Find me later.
Thanks. Thanks so much. Okay, our next presenter is Ashwin Whitchurch. Please welcome him. He's going to be talking about open source hardware medical instrumentation. This is your directory here. That will work if you'd like to run around here. This is your directory. Let me open this one for you. If you need to, you press the escape button and you can get to your video, but the video should work in your presentation, right?
Yeah. Hi. I'm really honored and also a little bit nervous to be here because there's such a big, great gathering here. My name is Ashwin, and I run a company called Proto Central in India. We're based in Bangalore. What we do is we make open source hardware specifically for medical devices, and we also sell a bunch of cool open source hardware from all our partners. So I'm going to be talking about a cycle that is going on in, within me and how I first fell in love with open source hardware, when I first got to meet open source hardware, how we used them later in medical devices and medical research projects that we are working on, and how we used it even more, and now how we are contributing back to the open source hardware field. So this is how my this was my first open source project that I've seen. It was called OpenEEG. This was back in 2001, and at that time OpenBCI was not around, and and EEG was still new, and it was very difficult to do. So we got started with this project where we wanted to make a wireless EEG headset using Bluetooth, but the problem was both EEG and Bluetooth were difficult for us because of the limited resources that we had. I was my first year of college. But this website really helped us. I mean, OpenBCI, they gave us the schematics for a basic EEG amplifier and how to hook it up to electrodes and then the rest of the things. So you can see a pretty, I think it's a pretty bad picture of a board that we made. That was the initial board that we made. And since we didn't have resources or money to buy boards from OpenEEG, we made our own board. I mean, that board that you see there is the EEG, six-channel EEG amplifier, and I didn't have access to Eagle even at that point. So, I mean, you wouldn't believe that I actually drew the PCB out on Microsoft Paint and then etched it out of copper. and the really ugly looking box that you see on top is our enclosure, if you can call it that. So what I mean by the second arrow here is that this started my journey in open source hardware. It also got me into biomedical instrumentation. At that time I was doing my college in software engineering, which was completely different from biomedical engineering. But finally I got into biomedical engineering, and that led to my, even my thesis was on wireless EEG, and it was received quite well at the time. So the next thing I'm going to be talking about is, we are working on a lot of projects which use open source hardware in various fields, but today's talk is going to be on medical devices. So I'm going to be talking about two projects that are the most recent. We've worked on a number of them, more than 10 of them, but two of them which are more recent and which are more meaningful. So I apologize if anybody is grossed out with the video here. So what we've done is pancreatic cancer. I think everybody knows pancreatic cancer is a very common form of cancer. And I think pancreatic cancer got popular because Stephen Jay died of it. And everybody got to know what pancreatic cancer was. The operation for pancreatic cancer is called Whipple's procedure. And what it involves is resectioning, or just put it in crude words, cutting off the part of the pancreas that is cancerous, and then tying the pancreas. The pancreas is filled with an amylase fluid, so when you cut off a part of the pancreas, then the fluid starts leaking. So it's sutured back to the stomach or the intestine so that the fluid doesn't leak. And I've got a quick video here. Which shows the, it's not too clear, I'm sorry, I can share the video with you if anyone's interested. What it shows is the doctors suturing the pancreas back to the, it looks pretty crude, but it's that's how the Whipple's procedure is done. And we've been lucky to have partnered with Dr. Ravichandran from Stanley Medical College in Madras in India, who is one of the doctors who is an expert on Whipple's procedure. So the problem here is As I told you, the fluid leakage happens due to a lot of reasons, but one of the main reasons why this happens is because the knot is not tied properly. And if you want to put it so crudely, it's because of the knot is not tied properly. It's called the ligature force. And let me run this video again. If you see, there are two surgeons. One is putting his hand on the pancreas, and there is another surgeon who is pulling the thread out of the pancreas. So both of those forces are important. There are soft pancreas and there are hard pancreas, so both would require different types of force and all that. So the problem here is, and the mortality and the morbidity of the outcome, that is, to put it in very crude terms, mortality is whether the patient is going to walk out alive of the operation theater, and morbidity is how long is he going to live for after that. So that directly correlates to the fluid leakage. Now, the problem here, that not tying force, what is the perfect force where you can minimize the leakage, is very subjective to the operating surgeon. And there are only a few qualified surgeons in the entire world who can successfully do a Whipple's procedure. And since morbidity depends on that, it dictates the person's lifetime, the life expectancy. So this was the problem with which the doctor came to us, the surgeon, how to get more doctors involved. So what did we do? We tried to quantify the force that is there. So we quantify the force using some sensors in the operating gloves while the doctor is doing the surgery. In real time, it provides feedback to the operating surgeon or surgeons. And we used that data and tried to train more surgeons. All this work was done by the doctor. I mean, usually it's very difficult to get a doctor to work with any experimental devices, but there are some who are really interested in bringing in new methods and all that. So we were lucky to have Dr. Ravichandran from Stanley. So this is how it works. I'm just going to quickly go through it. We have two small force sensors. Those are simple flexi-force sensors that we got from SparkFun. And those are put inside the surgical gloves. And we made an Arduino-based device to digitize that and send it over through Bluetooth. And we made a Raspberry Pi-based display for that. So this was prototype number one. And as all prototype number ones look, it was pretty crude. So the box that you see there, that was our enclosure. It was a Tupperware box that we got and we put it inside it. It was for a couple of reasons. One is it was a prototype, and second one is it was easy to sterilize because anything taken into an operating theater has to be completely sterilized. And if you see the first picture, there is actually somebody, a student from Stanley, who's standing behind the doctor holding the box. That is because we cannot have long cables, and the cables, they don't allow the doctor to move the hands freely. So that's what we did in the first prototype. So now and this is how we applied the sensor. That is, so you see a force sensor. This was not a great way to do it. So you see the sensor, we tape the sensor to the fingers of each doctor, and then the gloves are applied on top of it. And in the top photo, you can see the gloves that we made actually being used. And this is our current prototype, and we've turned that box into an arm-worn band, which is with a small box which we made on our own board, which is also Arduino based still, but it has Bluetooth, and that's our board there, right there. And so here, this is currently under testing at Stanley. And it's been giving quite good results. I mean, it has already been tested over 28 Whipple's operations, and it's given good results. So this is a quick video of how it works. That is a phantom which is the doctor is operating on. And so he has to put the pressure, and the pressure is displayed here on the Raspberry Pi. So we were really excited after this project because this allowed us to do this very easily. I mean, such instruments are, the thing about open source hardware is it lets us do things for a lower cost, but the more important part is I think it lets us do things which are not possible before. There is no device that exists right now which can do this, and we are trying to come out with a device that can do this. So this is the first one. And this is something that is really exciting right now, transcranial direct current stimulation, TDCS. It's been a topic of a lot of controversy and debate and everything. So this is, we've developed our own devices for TDCS. You might have heard about devices like Think and Focus and all that, which work on TDCS. But we concentrated specifically on the treatment of schizophrenia. And this work was done along with another great doctor, Dr. Venkat, at the National Institute of Mental Health and Neurosciences in India, NIMHANS for short. So quickly, what is schizophrenia? It's a neuropsychiatric disorder, which means that it's physiological, and it has a psychological part also to it. So if it's physiological, it has to be treated. And this is another statistics that I had to put in. It's ranked among the top 10 disabling disorders by World Health Organization, and it's quite common also. Symptoms are delusions, hallucinations, disorganized behavior, and progressive cognitive defects. Sometimes I think I have all of those. So I'm wondering, but in reality, if you go to the hospital ward, I've already actually been there so many times, it's really hard to see the patients because they're completely out of control, and that really makes my day. I mean, it tells me, okay, we are working in the right direction. So what is TDCS? Some of you might have heard about TDCS. It's applying a small amount of current, which is 1 to 2 milliamps. And in some cases, for some extreme conditions, we go up to 6 milliamps of current. And they are applied on the scalp using electrodes, conductive rubber electrodes, and they are dipped in a saline solution. And they are put in these two positions. That is, the person you can see next sitting next to me is Dr. Venkat. So the first trial was on him. So until we got ethics committee clearance for trying it out, we tried it out on all of us. And one more important thing that I forgot to mention was that the wireless EEG what we developed in the beginning was for predicting the occurrence of an epileptic seizure. So there are some prediction mechanisms available, so that's what we were working on. And the reason why we got into that is because I myself have epilepsy and it's quite close to me. So yeah, I'm in and out of psychiatrist's offices. So it's reported to have several therapeutic as well as non-therapeutic applications. Therapeutic is it can be used for, and that's pretty clear. I mean, it's used for mainly what this doctor is using it for is schizophrenia and extreme manic depression, which is really difficult to control. The non-therapeutic, those are under that's under a lot of debate right now, and it's a very big source of controversy also in the medical field. And it's making a lot of news. They say that it can have cognitive enhancement as well as relaxation. In fact, the recent Brain Initiative by President Obama's government includes TDCS as a focus area. So we will just look quickly at how we use this in schizophrenia. When I say therapeutic, there is one more. There's still a lot. Okay, 5 more minutes. So TDCS, how it's being used, this is the most exciting part. I am going to run through this quite fast now because I don't have time. Treating hallucinations that are resistant to antipsychotic medications. So this was pretty exciting because what antipsychotics cannot do, TDCS was able to do. And the most common, I don't want to go into neuromodulation and neuroplasticity because we're running out of time. But what it requires is precision waveform generation of the current at the proper place. And the problem here was there are TDCS devices available, but they are not programmable to the right waveform, and they're just prohibitively too expensive. So this is the device that we made. It's also based on a SAM processor. And we made a display for controlling and monitoring the TDCS session. You can see the electrodes over there. This cost us less than $200 compared to another commercial system, which was $7,000. I don't know why current control has to be so expensive, because if the electrical engineers over here would agree with me that current control is a basic electrical circuit. So quickly, some experimental results. What we place it in a place called the DLPFC, which is the prefrontal cortex. For testing the system, we tested out the cognitive capabilities of the system. So we had the two electrodes placed in the two positions given there. And some tests were made. That is pre-TDCS and post-session. So so the test is similar to a memory game that we play. It's called an NBAC test. It's a sequence of numbers that appear on the screen, and the software called E-Prime is used. And then we measure how many numbers the person can remember, and the reaction time. So the two parameters here are reaction time and accuracy, how accurate and how react. So you can see some clear. This was data provided by NIMHANS after the experiment. So you can see that there is a clear difference between before and after TDCS application. So this excited us even more, and we've now started exploring other aspects of neurostimulation like TFUS, which is focused ultrasound, which is really in the experimental stage, and also auditory neurostimulation. So what did we do even more? So we made a patient monitor. A patient monitor is pretty expensive. So what we did was we have made this hat, Healthy Pi, it's called Healthy Pi, for the Raspberry Pi. So we've got a Healthy Pi, we've got a Raspberry Pi, and we've got a display. And that's what I've got here. And So what we aim to do there is it's a low-cost system, but still it provides diagnostic quality signals. That's most important, because there are a lot of off-label systems which are available, which provide mostly the false positives, false negatives, and all that stuff. So it's completely open source. You can't see the GitHub link over there, but it's open source. It's there on GitHub, and we've given instruction on Hackster. We use Hackster.io for our documentation. So here, we just have a video of how it compares with a normal Well-Challen patient monitor, and we got a very good correlation with that. And this is something that this is the main application that we're looking at, which is telemedicine. How this can be used in remote villages, especially in India, who cannot afford a patient monitor. We are not saying that this is a medical device. We are not FCC or FDA or anything certified, but something is better than nothing. So there's a live Plotly feed which is going on. So some of our contributions, TDCS, we are planning to open source it once the results are there. And open pressure is the first surgical tool that we spoke about. We've used it for other applications also, especially intracranial pressure monitoring. That is ICP, which is during neurosurgery. And I need to talk also about what could go wrong. And one thing is that you could... So just what can go wrong? Because this is, I think it's very important. That's why I'm not skipping this slide out. Open source and medical don't go well together because there are always medical standards to be followed and everything. And the misuse of TDCS is another very interesting thing because if you don't know where to put the electrodes and you put it somewhere, other than the extraencephalitis, that is other than the head, you could end up with even a cardiac arrest. So it's pretty powerful, but it's also, we'll have to do more, it has to be used responsibly. So other possibilities, false positives and false negatives, these are, I think, the material of which many lawsuits are made, and misdiagnosis. And so if the instruments are not calibrated properly and if they're not used properly, for example, an electrode is not placed properly, then it could give false positives. So the point that I wanted to make is that we've used Raspberry Pi as our display. So this has become a new scientific instrument. So instead of spending $1 million buying a scientific instrument, we've used Raspberry Pi for all these three applications. So final slide. So open source hardware has allowed us to explore the unexplored. So it's not just about low cost, it's just that it's opened up new avenues. And we've handled important medical problems where it has definitely made a difference. And we also need to remember that more power, more responsibility. So I wanted to talk about the cycle again. And I put it in a cycle because the cycle goes on, and I'm still falling in love with so much open source hardware, and the journey will definitely continue. And some of the things that we're working on currently is NIR spectroscopy, and also functional NIR for brain mapping, and how to make those devices cheaper and more accessible. So I guess I'm out of time. I'm sorry to take too much time. Thank you.
Thanks so much. And our apologies, we couldn't give everyone more time for presenting. It's a very packed schedule. I'm sorry about that. Okay, our next presenter is Justina Ossereni, and she's going to be going into the topics including open hardware and motor function. So please welcome her.
It works. So how many introverts are there today? I'm one of you. So this is my second time public speaking. And earlier on, Alison, the keynote speaker, was saying that there is always something that's unexpected that happens in a conversation or a real life. And I think today in the conversation we're having about open hardware, it is me. So welcome to my presentation. My name is Justina Osereni. And if you're interested in some of the projects I did in the past, you can check out my blog, devinet.me. So after studying and working in design and computing with different communities for a couple of years, today I would like to talk to you as a maker and as a graduate student who for the last couple of months was conducting research on movement impairments and developing a low-cost technology for motion analysis and scientific exploration. I also want to talk to you as an independent researcher working with elderly people, families, therapists, and primarily I want to talk to you as a granddaughter who's trying to understand what's up with my grandma and what does it mean to get old and how can we change the meaning of it. So first of all, I would like to share with you my prior experience with collaborative offices such as makerspaces, hackerspaces, and fab labs. There are many terminologies and context and location-based characteristics of these spaces, but they do have things in common and all serve as a point of exploration of different cultural tendencies, collaboration perspectives, boundaries of creativity, and directions of new media and technology. Also, they provide these exciting opportunities and fill out the gap in the education system. So for me, making things provided me this childlike, playful experience with technology, materials, and sciences. And ever since, I've been treasuring this connection quite a lot. So DIY making is considered to be a particularly effective way of learning and engaging people, since it requires knowledge exchange and collaboration. And there are so many different groups working with children, encouraging women, there are many groups in the developing countries working with the local communities, but what about elderly people? Is there a way we can use similar approaches to engage our grandparents? So this is my grandmother and she's my inspiration and motivation for